Hello, I am Flash Isaac, and today I shall be taking you through electronics in physics. Electronics physics. Physics is the study of matter in relation to energy. Study of matter in relation to energy. Matter is anything that has mass and occupies space. Mass and occupy space. Meanwhile, energy is antimatter. No mass and it doesn't occupy space. Energy is the property of waves. Waves are disturbances that travel through medium or space and they transfer energy without mass transfer, without the transfer of mass. We can therefore say that the universe is made up of matter and energy, or matter and antimatter, where energy is the antimatter. Remember, chemistry is the study of the composition, properties, and uses of matter. You may ask yourself, what is the composition, or what are the composition of matter? What is matter made up of? Matter is made up of atoms, molecules, and ion. Atoms are the unit of matter, or an atom is the unit of matter. It's the smallest part of a substance that can exist, and you cannot see atoms with your naked eye because they are so small. They are the unit of matter. And group of matter can combine, or similar matter, or a substance that is made up of one type of matter is referred to as elements, which means atoms make up elements, and elements make up compound. The molecule is the smallest part of a substance that is capable of independent existence. Since atoms do not exist independently, they combine. So atoms combine to form molecules. Meanwhile, ions are atoms or group of atoms that possess electric charge. They can be positive or negative. According to Dalton, is indivisible. But over the years, we're able to find out that atoms, they have what we refer to as subatomic particles. Particles. Subatomic particles are simply the particles we have in atoms. They are proton, neutron, an electron. If you take an atom to be like this, you can call here inside the atom, it is referred to as the nucleus. The nucleus is made up of proton and neutron. And proton and neutron, they make up the mass of an atom. So atomic mass of any atom or element is the sum of the proton and neutron, and they are in the nucleus. Meanwhile, electron revolves around the atom. In terms of charge, electron is negatively charged and proton is positively charged. The charge of proton, they are equal and opposite. Therefore, they try to balance. They become magnetic. Now, each element or atom, they have electrons in their shell. They are made up of electrons. Now, the electron in the atomic shell may be forced to be free, may be forced to flow. In that case, we are generating what we refer to as electricity, because electricity is as a result of free electrons. Matter or materials can be matter, non-matter, metalloid or semiconductor. Metals are devices or materials that allow current or electricity to flow through them easily. They have lower resistance. Resistance is the opposite to the flow of current. And a circuit where you have only resistance is simply a DC circuit, because in a DC circuit, only resistance opposes the flow of current. However, when you are dealing with AC circuit, you have other materials like inductor and capacitors, as well as resistance or resistors opposing the flow of current. In that case, it is referred to as reactants. Reactants being opposition to flow. They are non-metals. They do not allow the flow of current or electricity. They have high, very high resistance. For example, if there is a bare wire and I put this thing there, it will not shock me. Why? This is a non-metal. Semiconductors, on the other hand, they have conductivity between that of metal and non-metal. You cannot say they are good conductors, and you cannot say they are non-metal or non-conductors. So metals are generally conductors, non-metals are generally non-conductors. Semiconductors or metalloids, they have conductivity between that of metals and non-metal. They are in between. Now, semiconductors in their pure form don't conduct. For semiconductors to conduct electricity, we add what we refer to as impurity. And the process of adding impurity to semiconductors so that they conduct electricity is referred to as doping. Now, you may be wondering, the lecture is about electronics. Why all these backgrounds? They are very important. Do you know why? Electronics is a branch of science or physics that studies the flow of electrons in a semiconductor. So with this definition, you understand electrons and you understand semiconductors. Therefore, this is a good start to electronics. The difference between semiconductors, or the difference between electronics and electrical devices, is that electrical devices deal with the flow of electrons, but in a conductor or through a metal. So when electrons flow through metal or conductors, we say, okay, we deal with electricity. But through a semiconductor, we say we are dealing with electronics, which means electronics is a semiconductor physics. That is electronics for you. Now, you hear someone say, I am studying electrical and electronic engineering. What is electrical engineering and what is electronic engineering? Electrical engineering, they simply deal with high voltage, high power. For example, your AC, free refrigerators, these are electrical devices. But your DSTV, your television, they are electronic devices. So they don't use alternating current. They make use of direct current. Now, the current from your light source, power station, from your sockets, they are AC. But before they get to your TV, they are converted to direct current. AC, they change direction of flow. Direct current, they flow directly. They don't change flow. And devices using batteries are generally DC devices. So before this electricity gets to your electronics, it will change to direct current. And the device that changes this AC to DC is referred to as diode. And these are semiconductors. Ladies and gentlemen, you are welcome to semiconductor and electronic field. Let us take a look at band theory. Matter exists in three states: the solid state, the liquid state, and the gaseous state. The difference between the solid state of matter, the liquid state of matter, and the gaseous state of matter is the force of attraction between the molecules. It's how close the molecules are. For gases, the molecules are far apart. For liquids, a little bit closer than the way they are in gases. But for solids, the molecules are close apart. They are very close. The force of attraction between molecules is strong. They are very, very close. Now, since they are close, a molecule can move into the orbital of neighboring atom. It moves into the orbital of neighboring atom, which means there is overlap of orbitals in solids. And that overlap is what forms what you refer to as energy band. Intermixing of orbital. Now, what is an orbital? When you look at atomic theories, you see that is atomic theory. J.J. Thomson, Rutherford, Nebel's atomic theory. They all did their best to explain atoms. However, three big boy scientists, men like Erwin Schrödinger, Louis de Broglie, and Werner Heisenberg, they proposed the theory of orbital. We have three types of energy band or three bands. We have the valence band. We have the conduction band. And the energy band or energy gap, forbidden band. Or forbidden gap. These are the energy bands when you come to band theory. What is valence band? Or what is conduction band? Or what is forbidden gap? If you have this atom, like this, you look at something. This atom or this element has 12 electrons, 2 here, 8 here, 10, and 2 in the outermost shell. Now, this electron in the outermost shell of an atom is referred to as valence electron, which means the energy band that contains valence electron is the valence band. So which means here, these are electrons in the outermost shell. Hope you understand that. Let's go to conduction band. Although the valence electrons are electrons in the outermost shell, not all the valence electrons become free. Because for conduction to take place, we must have what we refer to as free electrons. Free electrons. These are electrons that must be ready to be pulled out, to be free to move. So, the band that contains free electrons is simply the conduction band. Then the forbidden gap is simply the energy gap. It contains no free electrons. It has no electron in it. Now, like I said, for conduction to take place, the distance or the separation between the valence band and the conduction band must be small. Let's look at conductors. For conductors, you see the electrons in the conduction band, electron in the valence band, and there is basically no space between the conduction band and valence band. So electrons are allowed to move, so they conduct. Examples of conductor: copper, silver, aluminium. These are good examples of conductors. Now for insulators or non-metals or non-conductors, you see that the distance between the conduction band and valence band, which is the forbidden gap, is very wide. Now, for this thing to conduct electron, it needs external force to pull this to here, electrons from the valence band to conduction band. But since the distance is so wide, it may be very difficult for this to conduct. Now let's go to semiconductors. Semiconductors, they also have conduction band, valence band, and the forbidden band or forbidden gap. But the forbidden band or the forbidden gap is narrow, very narrow. Therefore, we shall need external force to make these semiconductors conduct. And like I said, the process of making semiconductors to conduct electricity, it has to be doping. Because you need to add impurities, external impurities, to semiconductors so that they are able to conduct. Example of insulator: rubber. Yeah, plastic is an insulator. Then, semiconductors. The top semiconductors are silicon and germanium. These are the top semiconductors. Now, for germanium or germanium, the forbidding gap is 0.7 electron volt. That is the forbidding gap. While for silicon, the forbidding gap is 1.1 electron volt. So, band theory, valence band, conduction band, and forbidding gap. Do you understand this? For semiconductors, conductivity increases with temperature, which means as temperature increases, the conductivity will increase. Semiconductors are covalently bonded. In pure state, semiconductors are insulators or poor conductors, which means generally semiconductors, they don't conduct electricity in their pure state. And pure semiconductors are referred to as intrinsic semiconductors. Impure semiconductors are referred to as extrinsic semiconductors. So pure, in, impure, S. Your S, you always refer to that as impure, bad character, so you can take it that way. S, impure, in, pure. Now, the carriers of currents in semiconductors are holes and electrons. Conductors, they charge or they carry current based on electrons. Electrons are mainly charge carriers in conductors. But semiconductors, they conduct by means of holes and electrons. If you see the diagram I drew in energy band under semiconductor, you notice something like this. In the valence band, there is H, which refer to as holes. Then here, conduction band, you have electrons. So this is the forbidding gap. So semiconductors, they conduct by means of holes and electrons. Holes are positively charged carrier or positive charge carriers, while electrons are negative charge carrier. So the magnitude of the charge of the holes and electrons, they are equal but opposite. So holes, positive charge carriers, electrons, negative charge carriers. Semiconductors, they conduct by means of holes and electrons. Now, the majority carrier is the one that is in excess. If we have more electrons than holes in a semiconductor, we simply say that electrons are majority carrier. If we have more holes than electrons in a semiconductor, we say that majority carriers are holes. Now, the one that we have less, they are the minority carrier. If we have less holes than electrons, holes are minority carriers, while electrons are majority carriers. So these are the values for conductivity and resistivity of semiconductors. Now let's take a look at doping. Remember, we said that semiconductors do not conduct in their pure state. They don't. For semiconductors to conduct, we need to add impurity to them. Now, adding impurity doesn't mean pack sand and put or pack anything and put. No, that is not the meaning. Adding impurities to semiconductors simply means adding other elements. And the elements we need to add to semiconductor, the impurities for semiconductors to conduct, they are simply group 3 or group 5 elements. These are impurities we add to semiconductors. Remember, pure semiconductors or good examples of semiconductors, silicon and germanium. And these are in group 4. Group 4 simply means they have 4 valence electrons. They have 4 electrons in the outermost shell. Now, by the time you add impurities or these elements to semiconductor, the process is referred to as doping, which means for semiconductors to conduct, they need to be doped. They need to dope. That is doping. Now, what are group 3 elements? The group 3 impurities added to semiconductors are referred to as trivalent impurities. Tri, because group 3 element, we simply have 3 elements, 3 electrons in the outermost shell. While the group 5 elements or group 5 impurities are referred to as pentavalent. Pentavalent simply means 5. So pentavalent elements, they will have 5 electrons in the outermost shell. Take a look at this element. This is phosphorus. Phosphorus has 15 electrons in total, but only 5 valence electrons, which means electrons in the outermost shell. Boron has 5 electrons in total, but 3 in the outermost shell, which means boron has 3 valence electrons. So phosphorus is pentavalent, 5 electrons in the outermost shell. Boron is trivalent, 3 in the outermost shell. Now, these elements, they can serve as trivalent impurity. Examples of trivalent impurities are, or trivalent elements are, boron, symbol B, gallium, G, aluminium, Al, and indium, In. These are elements. Then pentavalent elements, phosphorus, P, arsenic, Ar, antimony, Sb, bismuth, Bt. These are pentavalent impurities we add to semiconductors. Now, semiconductor can be p-type or n-type. Whether it is p-type, positive type, or n-type, negative type, depends on the impurity you use. Let's say you use trivalent impurity, boron. What happens? Since boron has 3 electrons in the outermost shell, this one comes here, right? The second one comes here. No. It can come anywhere. This is what I'm trying to achieve. Comes here. This comes here. So I don't cross the line. Now what happens? This one is filled. This one is filled. This one is filled. We have one hole left to be filled. Since we have more holes than electrons, we form p-type. In p-type, we have extra holes because not enough electrons to fill the holes. That is referred to as p-type semiconductor, which means when you dope with trivalent impurity, you form p. Look at it, trivalent T, pentavalent P. So when you dope with trivalent impurity, you form p. You can use that to remember. Trivalent impurity gives you p-type. Now, in p-type semiconductor, what is in excess and what is deficient? In this case, you see that we still have extra hole, which means for p-type, holes are more than electrons. So holes are majority carriers and electrons are minority carrier. Now let's do something else. This phosphorus, it has 3 electrons in the atom, 5 electrons in the outermost shell. It is pentavalent. Now let's dope. This comes here. This comes here. This comes here. This comes here. So this extra electron comes here to stay. Why? There is no hole for it to fill. The holes are filled up, meaning we have extra electrons. What does that imply? Or what does that imply? If you dope with any of these pentavalent impurities, you will form a or an n-type semiconductor. For n-type semiconductors, electrons are majority carrier and holes are minority carriers. So bulk of the conduction is as a result of the more electrons or extra electrons. So ladies and gentlemen, do you understand doping semiconductor devices? The first one here is the junction diode, and the next one is transistors. Diodes are generally devices that allow current to flow in one direction. But in junction diode, current can flow in either direction. They are made up of two terminals, the positive P terminal and the negative N terminal. This is a typical junction diode, and this is how diodes look. Positive side and the negative side. The junction diodes, they allow current to flow in both forward and reverse direction. Diodes are generally used as rectifiers. What are rectifiers? Rectifiers are devices that convert AC to DC. Now, the diode has the p-type and the n-type with a small junction. This junction is about 10 raised to the power of minus 6 meter thick. The junction is also referred to as depletion region or potential barrier. The junction experiences opposition and prevents further flow of charge. This is why the junction is also called depletion region or potential barrier. So the junction diode has a junction which is referred to as the depletion region or potential barrier. Now, bias, a diode can be biased or non-biased. Remember, we said that the process of adding impurity to semiconductor is referred to as doping. But in the case of bias, when there is no battery connected to diode, we say it is non-biased. And when the diode is non-biased, no current flows. So that is diode that is non-biased. No current flows. Before we go deep into that, I wrote some things out. The advantages and disadvantages of diodes. The advantages are no heater. It is very cheap. It has a small size, which means it is very light. The disadvantages are it is temperature sensitive and it conducts lightly in the reverse direction. What does it mean for diodes to conduct lightly in the reverse direction? Look at it. Since diodes, when there is no current or no battery attached to it, we say it is non-biased. Now, in biased, a diode can be forward biased or reverse biased. Forward bias or reverse bias. Now, what is forward biasing and what is reverse biasing? It is a very simple concept. If you take this to be diode, let's say this, and you say this is the positive and this is the negative. If you have a battery, like this, if the positive part of the battery is connected to the P end and the negative side of the battery is connected to the N side, we therefore say that this diode is forward biased. And in forward bias, more current flow because the depletion region will shrink. It will get smaller. Now, a situation where the negative part of the battery is connected to the P end, which is the positive side, and the positive side of the battery is connected to the N end, which is the negative side. In this case, the diode is reverse biased. And in reverse bias, only small current flows. This is why diode will allow current to flow very well in one direction, then smaller amount of current will flow in the reverse direction. If you have this diagram, something like this, and you have a battery, if the plus of the battery goes to plus, minus of the battery goes to minus, it is forward biased. Now, there is a type of diode that allow current to flow very well in both directions. That type of diode is referred to as Zener diodes. So in Zener diodes, you have something like this. Zener. Current flows very well in either direction. And Zener diodes are used for voltage regulation. Now, diodes are used as rectifiers to convert AC to DC. They are used as regulator or control in circuits, and they are used as switching. Now, when it comes to rectification, converting AC to DC, you can either use one diode for rectification, you can choose to use two, then you can choose to use four. Using one diode for rectification, the result will be a half wave. That will be the output. You have something like this. Half wave. Now, why do we have half wave in half rectification or when we use one diode? It is because the diodes allow current to flow in one direction. Then in the reverse, very small current flows. Therefore, this works. No current flows here, or small current. Then you get another wave. This is the result of using one diode for rectification.
you get half wave.
Now, if you use two diodes, you get full wave. Now, for a bridge circuit, something like this, bridges. For bridge circuits, you use four waves. So for half wave replication, one wave, one diode. Full wave, two diodes. For bridge, four diodes. So transistors are three terminal devices. And the three terminals are the emitter, the base, and the collector. These are the three terminals of a transistor. And in transistor, you have the PNP type and the NPN type. The PNP type, they have the two outer parts are positive, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, and negative. PNP and NPN transistors. Now, transistors are three terminal devices. Then they have the three terminals are emitter, base, and collector. If this is a transistor, this is the emitter, this is the base, and this is the collector for PNP. Now for NPN, you see this is the emitter, this is the base, and this is the collector. This is the emitter, this is the base, and this is the collector. Emitter, base, and collector. What is the function of emitter? What is the function of base? And what is the function of collector? Let's take it to be this way. If this is your tank, then you have pipes. Then here, you have tap. Here, you have bucket. Let's take this tank to be emitter. Let's take this opening of tap, the tap control, to be the base. Let's take this to be collector. Emitter. Emitter is heavily doped. Heavily doped. Remember, doping is addition of impurity to semiconductors so that they are able to conduct. Now, when you dope heavily, you get emitter. Emitter is heavily doped part of the transistor. Now, it is rich in holes. Holes are positive charge carriers. So, emitter is heavily doped. It is rich in holes. And what does it do? What does the tank do? Tank supplies water to the tap. Then, when you turn on the tap, it supplies the water to the bucket, which means emitter supply charge via the base. So, the tank supplies the water to the tap. And this tap here is the base. What does base do? Base is lightly doped. Lightly doped. It is poor in electrons. So that when the charge are coming from the emitter to the base, they don't mix up or react. They are able to go straight to the collector. And base is made up of different material from emitter and collector. Emitter, base, and collector. The material used in making the base is different from the one used in making the emitter and the one and collector. Which means, if this and this have the same material, the base will definitely have a different materials. In summary, transistors, they have made up of different materials. Let's take a look at the collector. The collector, they are lightly doped. They are rich in electrons. Lightly doped, rich in electrons. And what do? They collect carriers, they collect charges. The charges can be electrons or holes, but they are charge collector. They collect charges, they collect the carriers. Now, silicon is preferred to germanium for semiconductors because it has smaller cutoff current. The positive terminal of the battery is connected to the P end, and the negative terminal is connected to the N end, which means that the emitter base junction is forward biased. For this part, you see that the positive end is connected to the negative part of the transistor. Then the negative part of the battery is connected to the positive part of the transistor. In this case, we say that the collector base junction is reverse biased. So here is forward bias, here is reverse bias. Now, how about we do something like this? If here becomes plus, then it simply means that here is also, here is forward biased and here is forward biased. That is simply biasing. If positive is connected to positive end, negative is connected to negative end, that is forward biased. In this case, this is NPN transistor. This is the emitter, this is base, and this is the collector. So the base is common between the collector and the emitter. The negative part of the battery, negative terminal, is connected to the N side. Positive is connected to the P side, which means the emitter base junction is forward biased. In this case, the positive part of the battery is connected to the N side, the negative to the P side. So this other part is reverse biased. And in battery, current will flow from a higher potential to lower potential. So current will always flow from this higher part. Looking at transistors, they can be used as current and power amplification, voltage amplification, as switch, and as electrical oscillators. In PNP transistors, generally, current will flow in, while for NPN, current will flow out. There are modes we can operate transistor. If you are using transistor as amplifier, we therefore use the forward active mode. Forward active mode. When a transistor is forward active or is in forward active mode, it simply means that the emitter base junction is forward biased and the collector base junction is reverse biased. As we can see here, so this is the base, this is the collector base, because the base is common, collector base, emitter base. The emitter base junction is forward biased, the collector base junction is reverse biased. So this is forward active. And when a diode is forward active, a very high current, forward current will flow. And while operating a diode, always make sure that the emitter base junction is forward biased so that as much current can flow. Then a diode can be set up in cutoff mode. When you want to use diode as a switch, you configure it in cutoff mode. In cutoff mode, both junctions are reverse biased, which means the emitter base junction is reverse biased. Instead of plus here, here becomes plus, so that negative goes to positive, positive goes to negative. Then here is also reverse biased. In that case, this is in cutoff mode. Saturation mode, when transistor is used as a closed switch, it is connected in saturation mode. In saturation mode, both junctions are forward biased. The emitter base junction is forward biased, the collector base junction is forward biased, and large collector current will flow. And we also have reverse active mode of connecting transistor. The reverse active mode, in this case, the transistor acts as an inverter. It is the opposite of forward active. So when the transistor acts as an inverter, the emitter base junction is reverse biased, while the collector base junction is forward biased. Emitter base junction is reversed, while collector base junction is forward biased. Because here, the emitter base junction is forward, collector base junction is reversed. Now, to make transistor to function as amplifiers, we can connect it as common base, common emitter, and common collector. Common base simply means that the base here is common to both the input and output. Because for amplifiers, the input amplifies. Even in your speaker, in your mic, your speaker is amplified. When you give hello, it has a lot of gain. It boosts, it amplifies, signal goes up. That is amplification. So for common base, the base is here, is common to the input and output. In the input, you have emitter and base. In the output, you have base and collector. For the common emitter, the emitter is common between the base, between the input and the output. In the input, you have the base and the emitter. In the output, you have the collector and emitter. For common collector, the collector is common between the input and output. In the input, you have base and collector. In the output, you have emitter and collector. When it comes to transistors and electronics, there are more things to be dealt with, like input characteristics, output characteristics, oscillators, amplifiers, and more. Now, this class, we stop here. While there will be other classes to further electronic physics. I hope you found this class helpful. If yes, feel free to like, comment, and share. And don't forget to subscribe to this channel for more amazing videos. Thank you.